Sharon Perrone. Before I was a USDA employee, I had the opportunity to partner with USDA as a PhD student studying the ways that we quantify and qualify soil health at the University of Minnesota Twin Cities. USDA manages the world's largest soils database, but our ability to accurately analyze soil health information is really limited by the wide range of methodologies that we use to analyze soil health. For example, multiple different methods can be used to analyze a single soil health indicator, such as soil organic carbon. Through the Science of Soil Health Initiative, USDA's Natural Resources Conservation Service partners with colleges and universities to conduct soil health research. And our team was really fortunate to be able to take advantage of research assistance through that partnership. The partnership is really special because it relies on using a standardized set of methodologies to improve usability of soil health data. In this video, we'll follow UMN's lab tech, Bonsa, as he walks us through one soil health indicator, aggregate stability, and one science of soil health method for evaluation using a modified Yoder device. On paper, this method can seem pretty complicated, but hopefully by the time we've walked you through it, you'll be running it yourself. What are soil aggregates? Soil aggregates are clusters of soil and organic matter that are bound together and can be broken apart from other soil particles. A healthy soil is likely to be made up of tiny microaggregates that can agglomerate into larger macroaggregates, creating many pore spaces for gas exchange, water percolation, and root growth. These aggregates are held together by biotic glues excreted by microorganisms and plant roots. Alternatively, when aggregates collapse, either due to soil disturbance or the lack of abundant microorganisms and plant roots, the soil will lose its pore spaces and become compact. This can lead to surface pooling of water and anaerobic conditions, as well as increased erosion potential and inhibition of root growth. The aggregate stability test is a test to measure how well soil particles will hold together when subject to a disturbance. To measure aggregate stability, you start with a dry soil sample that has been sieved to a uniform size. We use 8mm sieved soils. Then you take that dry sample and you subject it to moving water, which mimics a disturbance. As that soil is subjected to that water will rush into the empty pore spaces within the aggregate, and the change in pressure can cause that aggregate to break apart or slake into various different sizes. Because we measure our soil samples on a stack of sieves, that means that we can catch and calculate the fractions of soil as they fall into the different sieve sizes. Then we can calculate a single value called mean weight diameter that relates each fraction to its sieve size as a singular measure of aggregate stability. This apparatus is called a modified Yoder device. Our machine is set up to run 4 samples at a time. Each station consists of a drum filled with water and a stack of sieves. For our soils, we use 4 sieve sizes, which are sizes 2mm, 500 microns, 250 microns, and 53 microns. You may decide to use more or fewer sieves, or different size sieves, depending on your soil. In our case, we ran several tests to determine the best number and sizes of sieves. We wanted to make sure that soil did not get disproportionately caught up on any one sieve size, which would prevent aggregates from passing through due to clogging. The machine runs at 30 RPM with a stroke length of 4 centimeters. To set up the device, add water to the drums and soak the sieve stack. Then, carefully but vigorously tap the sieve stack on the bottom of the drum to release any air bubbles. Once that is done, make sure the sieves are still tightly bound in the stack and attach the sieves with the pin. You'll want to put the device in its highest position and adjust the water in the drums such that the mesh of the topmost sieve is just touching the surface of the water. We modified our device to add a removable watertight ring on the top sieve so that water from the drum does not pour over the top of the sieve. Go ahead and test the machine for a minute or two to make sure the mesh of the top sieve does not break the surface of the water when running, and that the water on the outside of the sieve is moving in concert with the water inside the sieve. This means you've successfully evacuated any air bubbles that could compromise the assay. When you are ready to run a set of samples, return the device to its highest position. Gently distribute 25 grams of sample across the surface of the top sieve. Hit the switch to start the device and set a timer for 5 minutes. This time may differ depending on your protocol. When the timer goes off, raise the sieve stacks out of the drums and allow them to drain. Remove one stack at a time and collect the material in each sieve by turning it upside down and tapping it into a funnel over a small glass jar. Make sure you label and weigh the jar ahead of time. Use a wash bottle filled with DI water to collect any remaining material into the jar. Make sure you've properly rinsed any material on the funnel into the jar as well. Then, set the jars in a drying oven until they are completely dry, which may take 24 to 36 hours. When the aggregates are dry, remove the samples from the oven and allow them to come to room temperature. Then, weigh and record each sample. Your next task is to correct each aggregate fraction for sand and gravel. That is, we need to distinguish between what is an actual aggregate and what is a mineral particle that is simply too large to fit through the sieve, which we generally refer to as sand and gravel. For each sample, add water to the jar and use the wash bottle to transfer all soil back into the same sieve that the sample originally came from. Using a small rubber spatula, gently break up the aggregates and use a gentle stream of room temperature water to pass any soil particles through the sieve. Use a bucket to catch the wastewater and prevent clogging the drain. You'll see that the sample is ready when the water pouring through the sieve is no longer brown or cloudy. Like before, use the wash bottle to rinse all particles back into the same jar it came from and return it to the oven to dry. When the sample is dry, remove it from the oven and again return it to room temperature. Then, like before, weigh and record the mass of the sample. For cleanup, you can compost all soil residue and rinse all jars with lukewarm water. By now, you should have all the values you need to calculate mean weight diameter: the mass of the jar, the mass of your soil aggregates, and the mass of the sand and gravel. Refer to the NRCS technical note 450-03 for the protocol and how to use these values to calculate mean weight diameter. This assay is labor intensive, so take the time to practice and figure out a system that's efficient for your lab. If you're interested in partnering with USDA on future soil health research, please contact Sky Wills at the research branch at the National Soil Survey Center to learn more about opportunities. Thanks for watching and for your commitment to soil health.